mover. And he says, brethren, when I came to you, I came with a wall. I came to share, but I had to adjust my message because you were babies. You couldn't take the heavy stuff, and that's because you were carnal. So I had to give you milk and not meat. And even now, you're still not able to deal with deeper stuff, heavy stuff. It says in Isaiah, if you have run with a footman and they tire you, how will you run with the horses? If foot soldiers are too fast for you, then soldiers and horses, you can never keep up with them. And Paul here is speaking about, he's speaking to the church and he's saying, you are God's people, but there's a crisis because there's carnality in the church. I have told my church that a church full of carnal Christians is a time bomb. It's only a matter of time before there's an explosion. Because carnality is dangerous. That's why you don't feel too sorry for people who have a pet that is dangerous. It's one thing to have a parrot as a pet when it's discussing and talking your business. You can just tell a parrot, shut up, or you can put a rubber band over its beak. But when people have a pet like a boa constrictor, I heard of a man who had an alligator in his house as a pet. You don't feel too sorry for people because it's a level of ignorance and stupidity. And when the animal finally gets them, you feel sorry, but it's like, they should have known. And in the Church of the Living God, carnality is like that. We may think it's okay, but it is destructive. Totally destructive to the body of Christ. And this is why Paul is so concerned. In fact, carnality is anything and everything that is unlike or against Jesus Christ. We are called to be like Jesus. Amen? Yeah. We're called to be like Jesus. Not called to be like the Church of God Holiness. Not called to be like Pastor Kim Evans. Not called to be like Pastor Abner Joseph or like Pastor Philip Burns. Not called to be like some great television preacher. We're called to be like Jesus Christ. Amen. That is why the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. Because when people saw them, they reminded them about this man from Galilee named Jesus. And they called him Christian, meaning Christ-like. Amen. Carnality means we are on Christ-like. And so Paul says, you are carnal. And another word for carnal is worldly. You act like just mere men. You act like unsaved people. It is spiritual suicide to live contrary to God's word and yet believe you are in good standing with God. It is spiritual suicide to live contrary to what this B-I-B-L-E says. And still feel that you and God have some special contract worked on between you. Have you ever wondered why great men who are so powerful, so anointed, have messed up and destroyed their ministries? How could they do it? And then you found out that while they were preaching, they were doing that stuff. And yet there was such a sense of power and you could sense was anointing. People are getting saved. We all know what Jimmy Swaggart and found that he was doing. I loved his preaching. Yes, he was Pentecostal and, you know, charismatic and that, and the doctrine was a bit different to us, but this man had God in his life. Powerful ministry. But you found that it was a while. For some years he was doing this stuff. What is the guy? The preacher on TV who liked to do really sharp muscle shots. What's his name?
Ed Long.
Ed Long. Bishop Ed Long. Pop me the man could preach and get a crowd going. But you found out he was dealing with stuff and bad enough with a woman but sending pictures of himself to guys. But he was a pastor who I'd love to see him. He was a man in his 60s. and his broadcast came out about 9 o'clock. So while I'm getting ready for church or Sunday school, I would just be able to love the church, the setting, the choir. And when he came out to preach, such dignity, such good exposition of the word, Paul Erg. Can't believe his name. Okay. But the founder that for about 15, 20 years, he was having an affair with his secretary. And many other women he molested. And then when his son, after he died, his son took over his ministry. And then his son discovered. His nephew took over his ministry, his brother's son. And in a few months of taking over the church, he resigned because he found out he was actually a Paul's son. He got a woman, his father, who was a minister, got a woman pregnant, and then made his brother accept and say that I got her pregnant to cover himself. The Bible says, be sure your sin will find you out. But how could some people go on in the ministry knowing they are doing wrong? You know how they do it? Because they look at the good things. When I preach, people cry. When I preach after church, ladies shake my head and say, Pastor, as you spoke, I got goosebumps. And he just says the Holy Ghost in the place. When they preach, people actually got saved. But they forgot that God says, my word shall not return unto me void. So don't feel that because God is blessing that you are in the right standing with God. Moses hit the rock, and out of rock, can you imagine me hitting this wall, and water gushing out so much it would knock me down, and it gives enough water to 2.5 million people. Moses hit the rock and a miracle took place. So Moses has to be in good standing with God. But God says, Moses, you have dishonored me in front of the people, and because of your sin, you will not enter the promised land. While the people are drinking miraculous water, God is angry with Moses because he sinned. Don't think that because when you sing, people get blessed, and because when you preach, people feel the Spirit, and because people who are spiritual have a great respect for you because you haven't deserved it. Things are not right. Don't feel that you are okay. The only test is the word of God. Are you there? Yes. And it's dangerous then, the spiritual suicide, to live contrary to God's word and yet believe you are in good standing with God. This is youth revival. And one thing your people cannot stand is hypocrisy. They can't stand hypocrisy in their parents. And what bothers them, sometimes we may say that they're rude. But sometimes because they're immature, they don't know how to control their emotions. When an adult comes up hard on them and rebukes them, they get mad. Because they say, wait a minute, she talking to me? She doesn't even know what I know about her. And it's only because they know if they cuss her out, their mother or father will put a couple blows in them. So they bite your lip. Now, look at the scripture here quickly. Let's read together. Matthew 6:14. You can make a note of this in your Bible, but let's read it together. For if you forgive men when they sin against you, will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive. Let's read again. Because that had to be something written by a Church of God Holiness pastor. So I don't have to bother with that. Let me ask a question. Who is speaking here? Who's speaking these words? Who is Jesus? Amen. His word is absolute above our opinion, our feelings. Let's read the last verse again. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. If there's anybody in this church who you hold unforgiveness towards, if there's somebody in your family who you hold unforgiveness towards, if there's somebody on your job or your neighbor who God said, I have not forgiven you. I don't care how much you cry when you hear the sound of the Holy Ghost cries. I don't care how much you get goosebumps and you feel the Holy Ghost when they sing that special song that you like. You are being deceived by the devil. That is not God moving upon you. Because God says, if you don't forgive, I will not forgive you.
Yeah.
And the devil is called an angel of light. Are you there? Do you love this preaching?
Yeah,
you better, because they're going to get it. 1 John chapter 3, verse 14. Let's read together. We know that we have passed from death unto life. So, how do you know you are saved, young people? How do you know you're born again? When it doesn't add you in a Christian man. When you give your heart to Christ, when you kneel by your bed at home, and you're driving and you're convicted, and you pull beside the road and you bow your head and you pray, and you come to this altar and you pray, and it says, hey, you ain't saved. How does God give you witness? He says, here is one way we know we have passed from death to life. This is how, why? Because we love the brethren. When you are saved, the love of God is shed abroad in your heart, and you love the people of God. Go ahead. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Does this apply to pastors? Yeah. Deacons? Yeah. People in the pew like you? Yeah. Everybody who says that they are a Christian, but they don't love their brother or sister, they abide in death. 15. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. You should write this down and read it home in the Bible. Let's do it again. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. Jesus says that you have said, thou shalt not kill. But I say to you, if you hate somebody in your heart, you are a murderer. Because God doesn't just look at the act, he looks at the heart. So when men see a woman passing by, and they look at her all the way over and up and down, they may never touch her, but in their minds they strip her naked. And God is saying those men have committed fornication or adultery. They are already guilty of the act because in their spirits they have committed it. And when there's somebody who, when you see them, you just, your face twists up, and your face may not twist up, but your spirit twists up. I just can't stand her. I just can't stand she. And then you jump on your phone and you begin to text. She takes you in. God says, yeah, you are vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
pastor, suppose I go to church and I just feel the Holy Spirit. Well, you feel a spirit. You feel a spirit, that part is right. But which spirit? There's a lady back home who, oh boy, nobody can talk in tongues more than her. Her husband goes to church. Her children go to church. They come to our church. But she doesn't go to church. She's from a church that believes in tongues. And I'm saying, but even if you go with your husband, go to that church. Go to, no, I don't go to church. Oh, but she has her experiences with God. Oh yeah, she walks with the Lord. She's close to God. That's, you don't understand. You don't understand how God walks with me. I'm sorry, sweetheart. I don't need to know how He walks with you. He doesn't tell me in His word, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. And if you think you move above the word of God, you have been deceived by the devil yourself. Are you with me? The moment we think we can violate God's word and still have some special connection, I'm sorry, the day of judgment will be a day of dark and grim revelation. We walk only by this, the word of God. Are you there? So, all of you men, you and your wife, having major conflict and you aren't treating all right? Doesn't matter if you pray for 6 hours a day, God is saying your prayers have been blocked. Deal with the domestic situation. Wives who are unsubmissive, deal with it. Amen. Somebody said, deal with it. Let's read on. Giving you the word. And so you guys, this is Pastor Philip Dunn's opinion, straight from the word. Amen. Let's read. This is Galatians chapter 5, verse 19. Together. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this because those are the things we focus on. All of them people in their impurity and debauchery. All of them people there in their drunkenness and their orgies, wickedness, witchcraft. But how about those other things? Sexual immorality. You have to be careful about that because that's what it bombards you with your hormones kicking together. But it isn't only young people, it is all over. There are a lot of married women who get into trouble because of this thing called Facebook. They link up with friends that they haven't seen from 20 years ago. And a conversation gets moving. And before you know it, they're beginning to say things to some man that they don't even say to their husbands. Idolatry, which is putting anything above Christ. Hatred. Discord, which means divisions in the family, in the church, when Christians can't get along. Are you saying that those who live in discord will not inherit the kingdom of God? People who live in jealousy in the church or the job at home will not inherit the kingdom of God. People who go into fits of rage, who you have to handle carefully because they blow up on you, that they will not inherit the kingdom of God. Selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy. Are you there? Church, we have to be careful. We will not go to heaven by popular vote. We are going to heaven by sheer weight of numbers. God is not moved like Obama who does this.
Yeah.
Okay, we are going that way. God doesn't do that. God is the same yesterday, principle, because no pastor on that day of judgment can beg God on your behalf and say, well, I don't know, it was my fault, I gave you a wrong teaching, but you know what I mean. Well, God will say, you be silent. This is judgment day. And every man will be judged for the life he lived. Another scripture. To the angel of the church in Laodicea, write together. These are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. Let me ask you, what is the state of the Red Bay Church? What is the spiritual temperature here? What is the spiritual temperature of this church? What is your spiritual temperature? Read on. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. Next verse. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, so you can become rich, and white clothes to wear, so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salt to put on your eyes so you can see. Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be honest and repent. That's why we say crisis. And it's not just this church. Across the church world, the church is in a state of crisis. Because believers measure themselves by other believers. And by comparing ourselves to each other, we feel as though we are not too bad. Because while I am not as I should be, I am better than she. For sure. And is she going to heaven? Am I going to? And if he's a deacon, I'm more righteous than he. And the devil has fooled us because we don't measure ourselves by each other, but we measure ourselves by Christ alone. We are supposed to be conformed to the image of the stature of the fullness of Jesus Christ. And Paul says in Galatians 4:19, I travail unto Jesus Christ, be formed in you. My burden is for Christ, not Paul. Christ to be formed in you. And he says there in chapter 2 verse 21, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I.